Okay. Mine is just sort of a thought, a fairly quick thing I'd like maybe some of you to react to, that intermarriage in certain segments of American society between African Americans and white Americans is quite high, right? Working class, working poor, that those lines seem to have really blurred in the last couple of decades, simultaneous to growing economic inequality, simultaneous to, you know, the criminalization of African American men. So how do we put those two pieces together, the sort of social with the economic and the criminal justice system?
I never thought that intermarriage was a panacea, so I don't know. Maybe yeah. Well, maybe Tyrone has a different view. I don't see any inconsistency.
I guess I didn't think that intermarriage rates were increasing that significantly between whites and blacks.
I mean, they're rising, definitely.
They're still low,
but they're still relatively low. I mean, the intermarriage rates between blacks and whites relative to other groups outmarrying is much smaller. So.
But is it true that they're higher in just those groups that are sort of, you know, the poor or working poor that are subject to the sort of criminalization of African Americans?
I don't know.
I'm not aware of any data that suggests that they're higher. I mean, there's a whole theory about status exchange, which basically argues that much of the black-white interracial marriages, they're shaped by poorer whites, typically white women, marrying higher status black men. So they're trading their racial identity for the social class. And that's a pattern that there's a sociologist here at Stanford, Michael Rosenfeld, who's done a number of studies on that. But I'm not aware of any systematic data that suggests that working class groups in general are more likely to outmarry than middle class or
upper class. I do think there's another question implicit in that, which no one has mentioned, that I think is perhaps peculiarly American, but it's the rise of multiracial identities, because, and presumably intermarriage is part of that, and the offspring and the mixing throughout the generations, but no one has really talked about how that, the rise of that in the U.S., and we see that in the census because now people are allowed to choose multiple identities.
The 2010 census, I think it's still only about 3% of all respondents who choose more than one, which is an increase over the 2000 census.
That's interesting as well.
That it's so few.
Well, I mean, I don't know what the actual data are versus how people identify themselves, but
I don't know what it means to talk about the actual data per se,
Take Barack Obama as an example.
It's as if somebody is truly something. I mean, I'm not sure what that really
But my point
really
is, let's take Obama as an example. Okay. He has a white mother and an African father, and yet we routinely, and he self-identifies as African American, and we routinely see him that way. So I'm just raising the larger question in terms of your first topic, which was how do groups come to identify?
Right. We do know something about the multiracial movement. Okay, now Kirsten will say that Barack Obama is a white man with a black father, but that's another issue. but the multiracial movement, I'm thinking of Kim Williams's book. It's what Mark More Than One or something. I don't remember the exact title, but she really argues that it arises out of the efforts of white mothers of mixed-race children in California who wanted to make sure that their kids did not get deprived of the white dimension of privilege, who pushed most heavily for the census to open up the options for categories so that people could choose more than one. Now, maybe Kim's wrong, but we do know that this is a movement that arose in that way, and it gained momentum precisely because there was some perceived utility to dissolving racial categories, and there was a view that the multiracial movement would help move us in the direction of dissolving the use of racial categories altogether.
The other thing I would add is just there's a interesting piece that's been done by Aaron Gullickson and Ann Moining, peers, I think, in social science research, in which they took both the 1990 and 2000 census. They took those two partly because 2000 provides choice, multiple categories, 1990 didn't. And what they did was they arrayed people based on ancestry and saw how they selected the racial categories. And what was striking about that was that those who had either black-white unions or ancestry per se were more likely or just as likely in 1990 as 2000 to select black. That is, not to choose the multiracial category. Native Americans and whites were more likely, or almost the same in 1990 and 2000, to select white. Right, so this is the hypodescent, right? But then Asians was the real, it was unions between Asians and either whites or Asians and blacks that produced the highest, a significant rise in the multiracial population in the census data. And so I think, I say that partly to sort of say, go back to one of my final points. Yes, we need to acknowledge racial progress, right? But we also need to understand the continuing legacy, right? And I think the fact that African American white unions or Native American white unions continue to choose the monoracial category in 2000 when given the option really speaks to that latter point about the resiliency of our legacy of the color line.